to introduce Dr. Claire Malamed, who is the CEO of the Global Partnership for Sustainable Development Data. She's visiting from London, where she heads up a global team based in 5 countries. And she's worked for many international NGOs. Last one was Managing Director of the Overseas Development Institute. She was also the lead author of A World That Counts, the report of the Independent Expert Advisory Group on the Data Revolution for the Office of the UN Secretary General. And today, she'll be sharing with us her experience bringing together governments, private enterprise, and NGOs to deliver and use data for sustainable development. So, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
I don't have a presentation, so we can leave that up there so that people will have the time to write down your email address. So thank you so much, Rania, and thank you to Mari and others, everyone else behind this. Full room on a hot night. I came up, I walked up the canal from my hotel and everyone was out there enjoying themselves. So congratulations to all of you who have remained committed and come to hear about data science, which is, let's try and make ourselves much more interesting than beer. I think I'm taking that as a challenge. So it's great to be here, really exciting. As Rania said, I run something called the Global Partnership for Sustainable Development Data, which is somewhat explanatory as a title. It's an organisation, I will spend 2 minutes, we're a very new organisation. I laughed when you referred to DataKind as one of the oldest of these organisations and then reminded us that in fact it was only founded in 2011, which just shows how new this field is. We are much younger than that even, launched in 2015, and very much off the back of the work with the UN and the UN Secretary General's office around the data revolution, and a sense that there was all of this excitement about a data revolution, a sense of all of this sort of possibility out there. But I think within the UN system at least, a kind of not a very clear shared understanding of how that can best be used for good and what the changes, what kind of institutions and infrastructure both inside the UN and between the UN and other bodies was going to be best to support that. So the UN Secretary General brought together a big group, some from inside the UN, from private sector, from civil society, NGOs and others, and we all sat around the table. It was a really interesting experience, produced a report, but the I think everybody who was sitting around that table felt that it was a really useful experience to have that broad range of people, of institutional perspectives, of disciplinary perspectives around the table, and also felt very aware that there was no other body within the sort of international architecture that brought all those different groups together to talk about data. So that is why the Global Partnership was created, to very much be, I sometimes describe it as a sort of, we're kind of like plumbers, we're the pipe boys, sort of create the pipe work. So there are lots of things that are going on. There are big, you know, academic communities around data. There are obviously lots of data science communities and organizations. There is a whole UN architecture of statistics that has its whole, you know, organization and shared norms and protocols and so on. And really what we're trying to be is the pipe work that can connect all of those different worlds. And find a way for people to come together at a global, regional, or national level to focus in on some common problem. So in a lot of ways, I think very similar to some of the things that you are and certainly will be doing here as this program gets going. So that's the preamble. I think we're all here, really, you know, all of us in this room and all of us in this field with a shared understanding and excitement of data as the sort of infrastructure which can power progress across the world. And a sense, I think, as Rania showed very clearly in the slide with the car and the bike, of, you know, everybody knows this, and there are some entities that are investing hugely in the resources and the capacities to really be able to sort of seize the opportunities that that they see in front of them, and others, for different reasons, who are more constrained in being able to do that. And I think what we share, though, is this sense of the importance of data. And I think one of the real critical reasons for having this conversation between public and private sector in particular is to really try to understand, you know, what is the bit of this, particularly what is the bit of all of the investments that the private sector are making that drives a lot of the excitement, a lot of the glitz and glamour around this whole field. What is there which is actually relevant immediately to solving real sort of social, economic, environmental problems that we confront in the world today? What is, put another way, what of all of this, what is it worth the public sector spending taxpayers' money on, is another way to think about it. So we are very much within the partnership about trying to bring together these sort of worlds of the public and private sector and see where are the overlapping, where are the points on the Venn diagram that overlap, where we can really usefully bring together these different worlds and create something else out of that. But I think it is worth sort of stepping back for a minute also and remembering, you know, we sort of talk about a data revolution and all the amazing things that we can do about data, and we all get so excited about being able to track Google Maps in real time, and it is exciting. You know, I'm absolutely not. But I think it's really important as we do that to remember how many people and things and places in the world are still wholly outside of this data revolution and entirely invisible within this data infrastructure and architecture that we're seeing kind of growing up all around you. You know, so, you know, we're all always on the phone. You know, we want to, I mean, I did this today. I stopped worrying about how to get anywhere because I know that I can just look, I can sit in my hotel room on the other side of the canal, I can look at Google Maps, I'll just follow the blue dot and here I am. You know, we don't have to worry anymore about how to get, but there are still some places in the world that are not mapped. When the Ebola crisis broke out in West Africa in 2013, there were villages in which Ebola cases were known to be happening that were not on a map. They didn't physically exist on a map. So that, I mean, that just made the job of health workers slower, more difficult, more uncertain, take longer, be more expensive before they could get those life-saving treatments to those people and control the spread of the epidemic. So not being on a map really matters for all kinds of reasons. Not, you know, that is a particularly dramatic case. And then there are people who don't exist, who are not registered as individuals, who don't feature in the data as their sort of individual data points. You know, we all see, you know, I don't know, my first child was born in 2001. So I can look at the number of babies born in the UK in that year, and I know that one of them is my daughter. And yet, in many parts of the world, in Somalia, for example, which is the kind of worst case, only 3% of babies who are born are registered. So that is 97% of children who are born in Somalia who just don't sort of exist in an official sense, who can't be traced. So how can you be sure that you're protecting girls from early marriage or from FGM or any of the things that we want to help to protect children from if you don't actually know that they exist in a kind of, you know, in a sort of real and formal way? And then there are so many things that are not counted. You know, so many areas of economic activity still that we don't count, you know, despite the spread of mobile money. And you know, and when you do start to do this, the results can be amazing. One of the countries that we work with most closely is Ghana, where they have a fairly new government that are really excited about the possibility of sort of, you know, what can be done with some of these new data sources. They're really pushing ahead with all kinds of things. One of the things they did some time ago that kind of sparked off this confidence in data as the solution to some of their problems was they had a very sort of gifted and energetic statistician called Omar Saidu, who we work with closely now in the national administration, but then he was working at the district level. And he realized that the district authority, which was responsible for local taxation, actually didn't have any sort of records and data of the houses and the businesses that existed in the local area and who was, you know, what business. Went out and did a census, a little mini census of the area, mapped it out. The tax income of the local authority in that area increased by 500% in 1 year and stayed at that level. It wasn't just a one-off thing, it's still there. And, you know, just think of all the things, the roads and the schools and all the things that then came from that. So this sort of point about being, in, you know, we have to remember with all of our excitement about data that there are so many really fundamental ways in which we have huge gaps in the data and gaps that really matter to people's lives. I mean, I always feel, you know, it's easy for to think, and it's important in some contexts to get the job done. We need to think about data as a technical issue, as a there's a specific set of hard-earned skills that you all have that really, you know, require a great deal of dedication. But data is also such a highly political issue. You know, the sense in which being invisible creates a sort of powerlessness in people in relation to how they are, how they're treated, how they're seen, how they're dealt with or not dealt with by governments. And I think that we have to see data both as a technical thing, a sort of series of technical questions and problems to be solved, but also as a highly political issue of social justice, really just as much as debt or trade or aid or any of the other things that civil society organisations have campaigned on through the years. Of course, you know, this is a very, we're kind of at an exciting moment, lots of, you know, I'm sure you've had people standing up saying this before, and this is, you know, lots of people are saying this, it is an exciting moment where it does feel like we're kind of starting to build up a body of knowledge and sort of momentum for action, where we're starting to see things happen. So again, one of the things that members of my network are involved in is not so different from the example that you had of the data kind housing project, it's but on a bigger scale. So Afghanistan, for example, not had a census since 1979 for entirely understandable reasons. It's not been the safest place to do a census still then. But that's, you know, that's a whole generation, a generation and a half of not being able to have to know who's there, who's in the country, where they live, whatever. But now with using again, the satellite data plus sort of ground truthing that with some sample surveys in different places, they've done essentially a sort of an estimate, but it's a good estimate of the census of an Afghanistan census, and say for the first time in nearly 40 years, it's incredible. And there are so many good examples of that going on around the world, and that's very much kind of what we try to do. Lots of these things are happening anyway. It's not that the partnership necessarily needs to make them all happen. You know, you all have your own examples of things that you're working on. But what we try to do is to share these examples so that knowledge can be disseminated, and really particularly to try to see where things can be scaled up. I think as many other, you know, those of you who are involved in the sort of development sector, if there's anyone else in the room as opposed to the data science center, will know that there is this kind of, there's this sort of mentality of kind of pilotitis, you know, where we always have to do things very small, and the first reaction is always, let's just do a very, very small thing, and then let's go and do another very, very small thing. And we set ourselves an incredibly high standard of proof. I sometimes kind of wonder when would we ever know whether something was sufficiently successful. But I do think there are a lot of things in the world of data now, like this census example, where we have a sufficient level of understanding, of experience, of expertise to know that we can go to scale on some of these things. And that's a really exciting prospect. I should also add that the census in Afghanistan, this census in Afghanistan cost about one-tenth of the amount of what it would cost to do a traditional census, which obviously if you're a cash-strapped government in, well, any part of the world, that's pretty interesting. So, I thought I would sort of, after lots of examples, I thought I would kind of take a step back and just think about what's the job that needs to be done, and kind of what, how would I see, an initiative like this, people who are sort of interested in data for good, who want to, either coming from the kind of technical side, or from the civil society side in particular, of those who are kind of interested in from the civil society side in trying to think about how can get engaged in data issues and what is the problem to be solved and the job to be done. The core, I think, of it is really understanding, and here's the sort of economics background coming out, but I think one of the key ways to think about this is about matching demand and supply. And I think often with data, we get it gets driven very much by the new and the exciting and the shiny, and I'm more in favour of the new and the exciting and the shiny, and I absolutely don't want to sort of burst anyone's bubble on that for a minute. But I think to be successful in terms of creating social change with data, that has to be about combining the question and the answer, and not just starting with the answer and assuming that the question will come along in time. And I think it's about really sort of understanding what are the problems that people are trying to solve, what are the things that people want, how will they use it, and even not just what's the question, but how will they then use it? Who are the people who are going to use the thing? What will they do with it? What is the institutional framework in which it will be used? How will you make sure that if the person who you're talking to leaves, that somehow that institution is also connected to it? So there's a whole set of quite dull and massively important things which have nothing to do with data that are really fundamental in actually the sort of mechanics, the nuts and bolts of creating, of using data to create social change. And that's very much the things that I think we've learned in our first 2.5 years of operation. We started out, slightly sort of blinded by the data, thinking, oh, this is all different, this is all a big technical problem to be solved. That turned out to be the easy bit. The hard bit is actually making sure that what you're doing is useful and used. And I think it's that last, which is the hardest thing of all. So I think if you're sort of as you think about this program and that would be the one thing that I would sort of share from our experience. And I think, just to end, this is a bit of a sort of wish list on my part, really. As you're thinking about sort of data and civil society and bringing together these different worlds, I think there are three sort of critical roles that civil society organisations in particular can play here and will need the sort of support and the expertise and the encouragement of data scientists to sort of be walking hand in hand with them to be able to do that. And the first we've already talked about, that great slide you had with all the really helpful examples of how that can work, the kind of just using data to make their own operations more effective, whether that be in the fundraising or the assessment of fraud or whatever. And that's not small. But I would say two other things, if I could, add to the list. I think one, as I sort of was alluding to at the beginning, is about seeing data inequality as part of a wider struggle for equality, and that understanding that as we are building this new world in which data is sort of one of the raw materials of production, it's one of the things, I hate the analogy of data as the new oil, but it's impossible to kind of not sometimes slip into it. But I think, as data becomes a resource that is powering progress, then we need to think really hard about inequality there, as we do in any other area. And I think here there's a sort of good and a bad. I don't think, despite all of the things I've just said, that we should look to data to kind of come and save us from it. Because, of course, we know that data used in the wrong way or in the wrong hands can and has been, and I'm sure is being right this minute, used in terrible ways. I don't know if it was big in the media here, but over the last couple of days there's been a news story that was quite big in the UK about a member of the new Italian government who said that they are planning to do a census of the Roma population in Italy, essentially in order to find out where they are and who are the ones that they can possibly get away with throwing out of the country and then do that. That's an example of where invisibility actually, if you're an oppressed minority, then invisibility might be the safest thing for you. So I think we need to understand the sort of how data absolutely can be an instrument of good, and I do believe all things being equal, it's better to be visible in the data than not. But just like anything else, the systems of data that we have are replicating all of the inequalities and discrimination that exist in the society already. And I think that's, as data becomes an important resource, we need to think as people who want to sort of change society in a good way, how that is distributed, how that is governed, all the things that we would ask of any other resource and any other asset which can be used to sort of undermine or to create inequality. And then the third thing, the last thing, is I think somehow we sort of ended up with two conversations going on in parallel. One is this conversation about all the great things that we can do with data and all the excitement, and the other is the sort of Facebook, WikiLeaks, terrible data, Big Brother, you know, they're all out to get you, don't share your data, don't do anything. And I think unless those conversations are brought together in a way that allows a conversation about how we're going to govern data, not just to close everything down and stop everything, but recognising, as we've been doing tonight, there's all this great stuff that can happen, also recognising, actually, there's all this damage that can happen too. I mean, it feels to me, I would put government squarely at the centre of that picture and say that's the job of governments, to regulate any resource, be it data, be it guns, be it traffic, to understand that there's a good side and there's a bad side, and how, what's the sort of social contract that we want to create in any given society that will trade those things off against each other, and where is society happy to be? And I think that's a conversation that we're just sort of not having at the moment, because we have these sort of two very separate conversations about data, and I would love to see them being brought together. So, thank you so much. Like I say, this is, I hope I've come across some of the sort of excitement of this. I feel like this is a huge agenda. It's really, really exciting. I think there's so much good that can be done in these very substantive, practical ways. You know, the girls in Somalia, the people with Ebola, but also there are these kind of big systemic social changes. And I think we somehow have to keep both in our heads at the same time and make them work together. It's a hugely exciting thing, and I'm looking forward to hearing more about it from everybody else.